celebrate Ramadan and Eid has been very special.
We have our annual iftar. We celebrated this year.
Watching the Daily Debate live here on Nile TV International. I'm Tahrir Hussein, and I have the pleasure of your company for the coming hour to talk about news stories that make headlines and also wrap a very important file focusing on Egyptian-Panamanian relations on this special edition of the Daily Debate for tonight, coming to you live from Nile TV studios. President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi and his Panamanian counterpart Juan Carlos Varela have met for several times, and it was the recent ones was on the sidelines of the General Assembly of the United Nations, stressing on the keenness of both countries in order to build constructive relations and boosting bilateral cooperation in the best way. Usually Thursdays we open the file of Egypt's relations with the outside world. Egypt is opening up to the outside world. Panama's president had praised the central role that is played by Egypt to strengthen stability, peace, and progress in the region, expressing his country's gratitude for the efforts of the Egyptian government and wishes to enhance this sense of cooperation. Concerning mutual cooperation between both nations, the permanent dialogue is going on between both governments, forward ever, Egypt and Panama. The two countries developed their bilateral cooperation in different areas, in logistics support, in exchange experiences, developing integrated economic zones and also ports that would achieve the most benefit for the optimal locations of both countries. And today we have every honor and pleasure to host with us exclusively on the Daily Debate Thursdays live, His Excellency Ambassador Thomas Guardia, Panama's ambassador to Egypt. Thank you very much, Ambassador Guardia, for coming.
It's a pleasure to be here with you again, Tarith.
We met in Ramadan.
During Ramadan, yes. It was about 5-6 months ago.
And you told us more about the beat of Ramadan celebrations.
Yeah, right.
However, tonight we have more than one important file. We have maritime cooperation, political relations, economic relations, cultural relations, and most prominently, of course, people-to-people relations. Mm-hmm. Excellency, thank you so much for coming.
It's my pleasure.
And ladies and gentlemen, we'll be talking Egypt-Panama relations forward ever. That's our file for tonight. Before delving more into that important file and outlook in that report on Egyptian-Panamanian relations, developing relations in the different fields, let's watch and we'll be back.
Fattah al-Sisi starts on Thursday a two-day visit to the United Arab Emirates, during which he takes part in celebrations of the National Day. Their visit reflects their strong Egyptian-UAE relations. Earlier, during his first official visit to the Gulf state last year, President al-Sisi gave interview to the Abu Dhabi television channel, during which he hailed Egypt's relations with the United Arab Emirates, describing them as excellent, adding that they will remain special. Al-Sisi said Egypt's relationship with the UAE are strong and balanced since it was founded by the late Sheikh Zayed bin Sultan al-Nahyan. Sheikh al-Nahyan, the UAE's first president, is considered to be the founding father of the federal Gulf state. Al-Sisi said that UAE President Khalifa bin Zayed bin Sultan al-Nahyan, the Emir of Abu Dhabi and the commander of the Union Defense Force, and his brothers had followed Sheikh Zayed's path and ensured that relations between the UAE and Egypt must always remain special. He also said that the two countries shared similar views regarding counter-terrorism. while citing big mutual projects, including the UAE's funding of the construction of 25 storage silos for wheat, the building of 50,000 housing units, part of the UAE's $4.9 billion aid package to Egypt. Sisi said his country's young population, which makes up 30%, stand to gain from the projects. Since after the war of UAE in 1971, Egypt and the United Arab Emirates relations were always at a good level and developing at an unprecedented rate. The bond of friendship between the leaders of both countries has reflected on the growing political, economic and cultural ties between them. As a result, UAE ranks first among Arab and foreign countries investing in Egypt. UAE and Egypt maintain a close economic ties and maintain trade between the two countries, with imports and exports between the two sides. The United Arab Emirates National Day is celebrated on the 2nd of December each year. It marks the UAE's Union Day between the six Emirates, which was followed by the joining of the seventh Emirate, Ras Al Khaimah, in 1972. The National Day of UAE does not stand for the nationalization from the British Protectorate treaties, which declared in 1968. It is the anniversary of the federal unification of the seven Emirates in 1971, which combined to form the modern-day country headed by Sheikh Zayed bin Sultan Al Nahyan, the federation's first president. Grand celebrations are held across the country to mark the event. Fireworks and car rallies are almost the most common activities. People will usually dress up in UAE national flag colors, decorate their homes, workplaces, cars and streets to celebrate the day with joy and happiness. Military processions are held at Abu Dhabi National Exhibition for the rulers of the Emirates, members of the Federal National Council and Emirati citizens.
As our first report on the show highlighted, the important visit that has been paid by President Abdel Fattah al-Sisi to the United Arab Emirates, a very important visit, a two-day visit by the President, highlighting bilateral relations between both countries, between Egypt and the United Arab Emirates, and it aims at confirming the both countries' dedication to further consultation and coordination. Egypt and the Emirates are discussing enhancing and strengthening regional cooperation and also bilateral relations. Presidential spokesman Ambassador Ala Yusuf said that the President is also set to participate in celebrations of the Emirates National Day. These celebrations are going to fall Friday. Earlier in November, if we have more concerning flashback in relations, the President received Abu Dhabi Crown Prince Sheikh Mohammed bin Zayed Al Nahyan, and in statements, bin Zayed stressed his country's unshakable support for Egypt in light of the special relations between both countries, between Egypt and the Emirates. And highlighting further the significance and the timing of this important visit, celebrating the Emirates National Day, we have with us over the line His Excellency Ambassador Mohammed Hagezi, former Assistant Foreign Minister. Good evening, Mr. Ambassador.
Good evening, Tarbid.
Well, a very important visit by the President to the Emirates, and it highlights the strong relations, the strong ties between both countries and the sense of the continued consultation and coordination.
Indeed, Tarbid, it comes in a very crucial and important time. The relations, as described by the President, is excellent, strong, and balanced. I add to that it is very special and strategic. As a matter of fact, the United Arab Emirates stood firm to support Egypt both politically and economically, and whenever there is a need to consult, both countries truly worked hard to enhance bilateral cooperation as well as safeguard the interests of the Arab world. In this very important moments in which the Middle East and the Arab nations are facing many challenges, being in developmental, economical, but most importantly, political disputes, as well as the threat of terrorism, consulting between the leadership in the two countries is deep-rooted, and I'm sure that we require the wisdom to confront the actual situation in the region, and no one more than the President and the Crown Prince and Sheikh Khalifa, as well as the Emirati leadership, that can really drive the way forward.
Mm-hmm. The President is always emphasizing on the unshakable relations with the Emirates, the support for Egypt, and definitely his sharing in the celebrations of the Emirates National Day is a message in itself, a message of friendship and of solidarity.
Yes, from a political and diplomatic point of view, when a President is invited to be a guest of honor in such a celebration, is a manifestation of the deep-rooted relations between the two countries, and from our side, being there in the commemoration of the 41st anniversary of the establishment of the state of the United Arab Kingdom, United Arab Emirates, is in itself also a show of continuous support to the bilateral relations. I have to say that since the establishment of the United Arab Emirates in 1971. Egypt remain a very close friend to the Emirates and vice versa. Allow me also to quote the Emirati ambassador in Cairo, Jumal Janabi, who said that the strong ties between the two countries is transformed even to be a unity between the two people. And I think this is in itself the call of the founder father, Sheikh Zayed bin Sultan Al Nahyan, to keep the ties between Egypt and Emirates always strong. And I think we are fulfilling his prophecy, and his sons are very fidel to this call. And my country is depending a lot on the unity between Arab nations, and the leadership of Egypt and the United Arab Emirates are only doing that. We hope that what we are hearing about the possibility of closing ranks with differences between Arab countries, and maybe a meeting between Egypt and the Saudi leadership will come. The Emirates is playing a very important and crucial role in mediating between brothers, and I think Arab solidarity is ever required.
Right, Excellency Ambassador Mohammed Hagazi, former Assistant Foreign Minister, thank you so much for highlighting that important headline, the President's starting two-day visit to the United Arab Emirates and the unshakable bond and support between Egypt and the Emirates. Well, in celebration, both countries, of course, attending the country's National Day, this short break, and we'll be back from Egypt relations with the United Arab Emirates to Egyptian-Panamanian relations. We'll be back. So a big salute from the Egyptians to our Emirati brothers. And today also we are discussing on the file Egyptian-Panamanian relations. I have all the honor to have with me live in Nile TV studios exclusively His Excellency Ambassador Thomas Guardia, Panama's ambassador to Egypt. Excellency, a very solid foundation in relations between both countries, Egypt and Panama. And we're moving forward on more than one horizons, politically seeing eye to eye in coordination, and also financially, just name it. We're talking logistics, we're talking more about the cooperation between Suez Canal and Panama Canal and more.
Yes, definitely the cooperation between Panama and Egypt is increasing in the last few years. As you mentioned, President Varela met with President Sisi at the sidelines of the UN General Assembly the last year. And from this meeting, we have been strengthening the cooperation, especially focusing on maritime and logistic issues, which I think it's one of the common areas we have between Panama and Egypt. So definitely this is one thing that we will keep working on with among the authorities in Panama and Egypt, both from the Suez Canal Authority and also the economic zone of the Suez Canal, and the Ministry of Transportation, which oversees as well the logistics and maritime issues in Egypt.
Right. Well, building on this sense of cooperation, and especially in maritime cooperation, how will it reflect on the world trade at large? And the sense of cooperation between the Suez Canal Authority in Egypt and Panama Canal?
Well, this cooperation is mostly exchange of information. Mm-hmm. And hopefully will also include some exchange of training for workers of the Panama Canal and the Suez Canal, even though both canals work quite differently, as you know. Mm-hmm. One canal, the Suez, is a sea level canal, and the Panama Canal is a lock system canal. So, but there are similarities among both of them. But definitely this is something that we are looking very much forward. Both canals have undertaken very multi-billion dollar investment to maintain the competitiveness of each canal. The new Suez Canal that was opened last year, and congratulations, I've said it before and I say it again, to the government, to President Sisi, to Amir Mamish for the hard work they have done, and to open this work, impressive work in 1 year. And Panama as well, just recently, I think we will talk about this in a short while, opened the expansion project, which was a 5.25 US billion US dollars investment in Panama. Mm-hmm. So definitely we're both working together to maintain the good quality and competitive of the two main sea lanes for world trade.
Right. How did this hard work, as you've mentioned, Excellency, resonate in Panama? I mean, how did like Panamanian businessmen find more opportunities investment, for instance, in the Suez Canal economic zone? I guess it provides lots of facilities and opportunities.
Well, yes, the Suez Canal economic zone, I think, opens very much opportunities, not only for Panama, but for many investors around the world. And this is definitely one thing that Panama is looking very closely, the possibility of having investments, but also the exchange of information and practices, what works and what does not work. Have in Panama, what we have been experimenting in, what Egypt has been doing as well. So I think the cooperation among government as well as investors is quite important to exchange the best legal frameworks for these economic zones, how best to work, and how best to attract investors.
Yeah. Apart from maritime cooperation, what other areas of cooperation, what unconventional doors that both countries have managed to unlock?
Well, I think culture is one of the things that we've, this one of our priorities as well, that we've been working very hard with. Recently, we had the participation of Panama in the Cairo Jazz Festival, which took place about a month ago. And we were very pleased with this participation of Panama. It's the first time that Panama actually participates in this festival. So we had a group of musicians coming, and they had a very interesting interaction with Egyptian musicians, and the was entitled the Panama Pan-African Jazz Project.
Right.
Panama and Africa, Egypt. And so it was very, very interesting.
A new experience, a new exposure.
Totally, totally, totally unconventional, as you say.
Yeah.
So it was, we're very proud of this first step that was taken, and we hope it's only a first step that Egyptian musicians will participate in the Panama Jazz Festival that will take place, which takes place every year at the beginning of the year. And to continue the participation of Panama in this Cairo Jazz Festival.
Right. Well, we have different areas of cooperation, political issues, of course, seeing eye to eye concerning political coordination between both countries. We have also the business file, which is a very important file, and also learning from the Panamanian experience concerning the expansion of Panama Canal. What are the lessons taught, Mr. Ambassador, and how can the Egyptian experience benefit from that?
For, well, from the canal, I think one of the main issues that we've been discussing, that we do need to invest in the canal itself, in the in the making each canal more competitive, and this means making it quicker for the ships to go through both areas, and to go and to to make it. In the case of Panama, make it to able to accommodate bigger and deeper ships. And this is was something that opened new markets for Panama. But the second lesson that we know from Panama is that it's not enough with the canal itself. We need to develop the area surrounding the canal. So in this sense, the Suez Economic Zone that was established recently, and that has been working before that establishment of that authority, is very important. The development of seaports, it's one crucial issue. Panama has increased its income from the handling of containers, for example. Just in maybe 15 years ago, we were maybe 300,000 containers passed through Panama, through Panama Panamanian ports.
Right.
Not talking about the canal, but transshipment of containers in Panama was around 300,000. Now we're close to 7 million containers passing through Panama.
So a real transformation.
So it's a real transformation in a relatively short period of time. We have developed new seaports, and we are, in this moment, we are launching an international bid for the development of a new seaport on the Pacific side. So right now we have five seaports. I hope in a few years we will have six. And the existing ports are also investing to increase the capacity of management of containers and other cargo. So this is very important. The Panama Canal is also developing new, exploring new activities. For example, in the logistic parks. And I think this is something that very well Panama and Egypt are exchanging information, are exchanging best practices, and this will help the development. It's not good enough just to charge a toll or and to see the ships pass by. You have to develop and take the best opportunity of the privileged geographical location that Egypt has, uniting the Mediterranean with the Red Sea and the Pacific, the Asian Pacific region, and Panama on the other hand, connecting the Pacific with the Atlantic and opening up to the east coast of the of North America. So so we both have a very good geographical location.
Potential.
And we have to make the best opportunity of it. I think we're...
How can we make the best opportunity of it, Mr. Ambassador? that was my next question, because it's a sense of privilege. We have strong points for both countries in this domain. And this exceptional geographical location, as Your Excellency have just mentioned, is a plus. and it should be further widened. I mean, we need to further coordinate so that we can, like, reap the fruit.
Yes, definitely. Mm-hmm. I mean, Panama has a very small population. Panama, we're only 4 million persons, which is just a small neighborhood in Cairo. But we've had one of the fastest growing economy in Latin America, and we're very proud of that.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the motors, probably not the only motor, but one of the main motors of our development has been the logistics sector.
Yeah.
And how this logistics sector, not in seaports, as I've mentioned before, I shared with you the big increase and the rapid growth in the seaport, but also in the import and re-export of goods through our duty-free zone.
Mm-hmm.
So these are areas that contribute to the national development. And precisely, I think all the development from Sogna all the way to East Port Said that is being done right now, and which is projected to be done, will contribute greatly to the national development of Egypt. So we have to take advantage of this. Now, everybody talks of logistics, even though logistics have been around from a very long time, even from the ancient pharaonic
times. But the term now sounds familiar, more familiar.
I mean, just imagine the logistics necessary to build the pyramids.
Right.
It was incredible.
Mm-hmm.
All you need to bring the rocks from the quarry and moving and all that was a logistical operation. Can you imagine that?
Yeah.
And even from the Greeks, I mean, we've know this. But today that is a buzzword. And the world moves around hubs.
Mm-hmm.
It's the hub and spoke. And we need, Egypt is a potential great hub in this part of the world, as well as Panama.
Yeah.
And we need to increase that. We need to, as you said, more investment, national investment in infrastructures, and also the possibility of attracting private foreign direct investment.
Right.
I think we have to have both. We cannot depend solely on national investment, but we have to open up for foreign direct investment.
Right.
And that means having a good economic health. It means having good laws in place,
that incentives
that facilitate the investment, but that also safeguard our national development.
Right.
It's not to give land away or give excessive privileges, but make it attractive enough and getting the returns that we need, because we're putting the most important part, we're putting the land, we're putting the heart of our nation.
Yeah. We're trying to make it attractive enough, as Your Excellency was just mentioning, but it's very important for like Panamanian businessmen to come and see for themselves. I mean, are there exchange visits so that this would reflect on the volume of trade and doing business with Egypt? Are there visits for Panamanian businessmen to the Suez Canal Access Plan area, and so that they would see for themselves the potential that the area offers?
Well, right now we're talking more about government-to-government cooperation rather than private investors. Panama, I think what Panama can offer to Egypt at this time, and as well Panama learned from Egypt, are the legal frameworks and the incentives in place.
Yeah.
What works, what does not work for national development. So definitely, I think...
Memorable moments here with the president?
Oh, yes.
Yes. I guess a very memorable photo for you.
Yes,
tell me more about that meeting.
Well, that was a presentation of credentials.
Right.
And as you know, it's a very protocolar meeting.
Right.
And they told us we had 90 seconds to exchange with President al-Sisi. It was a pleasure.
Yeah.
So I took up the opportunity to transmit to His Excellency the President the congratulations from President Varela for the hard work being done in the new Suez Canal, and to help the disposition of helping Egypt with logistics sector.
Right, and here also with His Holiness Pope Tawadros, I guess.
Yes.
Yes, with His Holiness Pope Tawadros II. It's very important also our sense of coordination concerning disseminating peace definitely to the world, and we here in the country were working definitely on developing also religious discourse, and definitely we are in a country where we both Muslims are and Christians are Egyptians in the
yes,
first place.
Yes.
We are living in this sense of peaceful coexistence. So your impressions of the meeting with the Pope here with Admiral Mamish,
yes.
Yeah, and this is after the discussions concerning maritime cooperation and ports expansion, right?
That is correct. Going back to the previous picture of with the Pope Tawadros, definitely Panama believes that on the culture of peace, and we strongly promote the culture of peace. So mm-hmm. I believe that it was important for me to meet both the heads of the Grand Imam.
Grand Imam of Al-Azhar, Sheikh
yes.
Ahmad Al-Tayyib, and His Holiness Pope Tawadros.
And Pope Tawadros, because they represent, Egypt, mostly a Muslim community, but also was an important part of the population, being Coptic Christian Orthodox.
Right.
So I made it a point when I arrived to meet with both of them
mm-hmm.
and to promote this dialogue of culture of peace and peace through religion.
Definitely.
Through the tolerant mm-hmm. Religion,
the
through
acceptance
peace
of the
loving,
other. Mm-hmm.
And the debate and the understanding between different religions of the world. In Panama, there's a peaceful coexistence between the Christian community, the Muslim community, the Jewish community, the Hindi community, because there's also an important
diversity.
It's mm-hmm. so it's mm-hmm. the diversity.
Yeah.
Yes,
and so the definitely. Acceptance of the others, definitely.
Yes, so mm-hmm. Definitely this is one of the things that I would like to highlight from these visits that I made at the beginning. Yes.
Yeah, and here with the Grand Imam.
Yes.
Dr. Right. Ahmad Al-Tayyib, as you've mentioned, Excellency, it's very important disseminating, Grand Imam disseminating the true image of moderate Islam.
Yes, definitely. Yeah. This is one thing that we talked with the Grand Imam. This is something that he's very keen, and I've seen it during not only during my visit to him, but I've been following his trips outside Egypt as well, and his participation in many conferences outside of Egypt. Precisely promoting this peace dialogue
and debating
the true meaning meaning of mm-hmm. Islam. So definitely this is one thing that we very much appreciate mm-hmm. and hopefully have better and in the future exchange between the religious leaders of Panama with the religious leaders of Egypt. I think
that would be great,
something that we can mm-hmm. obtain mm-hmm. as you said unconventional diplomacy,
right.
I think can be geared towards that, bringing together because the religious leaders represent the people to
works,
an extent.
It's a win-win situation
yes,
and works okay. also reflecting on people-to-people relations.
Exactly. So hopefully we will, probably not the at highest level, but at least represent us from the different religious communities can be together.
And that reminds me also of the role of popular diplomacy as well.
Yes.
In relations between countries. The use of the soft power is very important. Your Excellency talked about like opening new horizons and knocking doors, and how the jazz festival was a very good opportunity. It was something different. It was a new exploration, a different experience in Egypt. What do we need to do more? How about the field of vocational training? And you have very good experience in Panama in logistics and vocational training is a very important sector to talk about.
Yes, vocational training and everything around academics is very important.
Mm.
And we've been working very hard during my time here in Egypt in our relationships with the Arab Academy of Science, Technology and Marine Transportation, which has its headquarters in Alexandria, as you very well know,
mm-hmm.
but it has many branches around Egypt from north to south. So we've been working with them, with the President Ismail, to establish MOU of cooperation between Panama and the Arab Academy, precisely for what you're saying, the exchange of professors, the exchange of students.
Yeah, education is
and
very
for
important.
Everything educational and around going back to the main theme on logistics and maritime transportation. So I think this is something very important. It should also be remembered that there's an important number of Egyptians and graduates of the Arab Academy, Egyptians and others, not only Egyptians go to the Arab Academy, but from many countries within the Arab League, because this is a subsidiary organization of the Arab League, that graduate from the academy and end up working in Panama flag vessels around
right.
the world. As you know, Panama has the biggest maritime fleet, commercial fleet around the world under the Panama flag. So many people from the Arab Academy and others are working in flag vessels of Panama. So this is something we're very proud, and it's a point of cooperation which we have between both countries. And as you said, this people-to-people in academic and education.
Yeah.
We can do more. Definitely
we can
do more.
Yes, definitely we can do more together. And we'll be talking about also a very interesting point that Your Excellency has raised earlier concerning logistics and the pyramids. How was logistics quite interesting in building the pyramids? How can we market that in Panama? How about tourism? And more concerning those files right after this report. Don't go away.
Been one of the fastest growing economies in Latin America over the past decade. The latest monthly economic activity data from July and August suggests that GDP growth moderated in quarter three. Nevertheless, the economy is expected to remain on a steady growth path, and the recently approved 2017 budget envisages increased spending and salary hikes for public employees. The budget is not expected to derail the government's fiscal consolidation efforts, since tax revenues are expected to increase on the back of higher Panama Canal earnings and improved tax collection. Large-scale infrastructure projects and higher Panama Canal revenues will support growth, but it will still suffer from flagging global trade. Analysts expect the economy to expand 5.4% in 2016, which is down 0.3 percentage points from last month's projection. For 2017, the panel forecasts growth of 5.8%. Between 2004 and 2013, real GDP expanded an average of 8.4%. Moreover, Panama performed relatively well during the global financial crisis, including 4% growth in 2009. When many other countries in the region suffered a contraction. The economy accelerated in the following years, reaching double-digit growth rates in 2010 and 2011. The economy of Panama is centered on a highly developed services sector, which represents more than 75% of gross domestic product. The Panama Canal and use of the U.S. dollar have promoted the strengthening of a globally oriented services economy. The Panama Canal is essential to global trade and accounts for almost 10% of the country's GDP. Other important components of the service economy are the Colon Free Trade Zone, the CFZ, which is the second largest free port in the world, and the Trans-Panama Pipeline, which allows for the transport of crude oil between the Pacific and Atlantic coasts. The license and the registry of the Panama flag to merchant ships is another source of economic activity. Panama also has a large logistics and storage services sector, as well as modern banking and insurance industry. The agricultural sector has lost importance over the years, accounting for less than 10% of GDP today. Expansion of the Panama Canal has been a major source of economic activity since the project began in 2007, estimated at a cost of $5.5 billion. The construction of wider locks and deeper channels will allow for passage of larger container ships, help the canal remain competitive in the realm of global trade, and therefore sustain toll revenues. Other large public spending infrastructure projects have also driven economic growth in recent years and solidified Panama's standing as a major logistical hub in the region. While the Panama Canal and related activity were historically the main economic engines, growth is now also being driven by modern banking and financial services sector.
People-to-people relations.
This is the first time I am terrestrial.
First interview exclusively, Excellency.
Thank you for the kind invitation.
In the name of Allah, we crossed. How was it that since that moment of crossing?
Actually, this is the fourth time of mine being here.
Celebrate Ramadan and Eid has been very special.
We have our annual iftar. We celebrated this year.
You're watching the Daily Debate live. Excellency Ambassador Guardia, talking about Panama's one of the fastest growing economies yes. in Latin America. Lessons taught. We talked together about the logistics sector, which is actually very important. What made Panama one of the fastest economies in Latin America at large, in your opinion? What made it a story of success?
Well, I think our system, which is an open market system, very open to foreign direct investment, promoting the entrepreneurship of Panamanians to open new businesses and to invest in their country. I think these are key factors, as well as we have a dollarized economy. We've had it since the early 1900s when Panama was an independent country. And I think the geographical location has been very important. There's also an issue that we must remember. While the U.S. was administrating the Panama Canal and the Canal Zone, all this area was under U.S. control. It was almost like a neo-colony. And this was returned to Panama at the end of 1999. So starting the century, this century, 21st century, in the year 2000, all that area was incorporated into the national development of Panama. So you can imagine not only the canal, but the areas adjacent to that. So all that hectares of land have been put into the national development. For basically logistics and seaports, logistical parks. You talked in the report about the Panama, the duty-free zone in Colón on the Atlantic side, which is the second largest in the world, the first in the Americas. So the expansion of the duty-free zone, all that has been thanks to the reversion to Panama, the recovery of our complete sovereignty over all our land. That's what meant the return of the canal to Panama and the zones. So that really gave a big push to our national economy. Many people were worried. They said, if the Americans, the North Americans leave, what will happen to Panama? We will economically, we will fail. And it has been the contrary. We've become the fastest growing economy in Latin America, as it was said in the report. For this year, it's projected that we will be between number one or number two in growth rate. And when you go to see the competitive index of the World Economic Forum, Panama has reached a very high place within Latin America. Mm-hmm. So the ease of opening new businesses and the logistics sector, maritime sector. But also, I would like to mention to you that tourism has become one of the main source of revenue for national development.
Yeah.
And it's increasing every day.
Mm-hmm.
And it's catching up to the maritime and logistics sector. through tourism, we have a very important air hub also in Panama. It's not only boats going through Panama, but it's also airplanes. Mm-hmm. We have a very important, our national flag carrier airline, Copa, has been increasing its connections within the Americas, from North America, from Canada, all the way to South America, to Argentina, Chile, and to the Caribbean, covering most of the Caribbean islands. So this has been very much increasing the number of tourism passengers, either that go through Panama, but more importantly, passengers that stay in Panama, spend their money in Panama, get to know the tourist offer that Panama has, mm-hmm. and definitely this is one thing of national revenue that has been increasing.
Yeah. How about tourists, Panamanian tourists coming to Egypt? And it's a very important file, you know. Tourism reflects on everything, on yes. business, on people-to-people relations, on also on exchanging culturally, knowing more about the monuments. We earlier in the show linked logistics with building the pyramids.
Yes.
A very, very interesting idea to... Yes. To like look at the pyramids from the logistics angle.
Yes, well, definitely tourism is in the heart of everyone when you think about Egypt. And I must state out in that we feel that Egypt is a safe place to come and visit, and we encourage people that write to us to the embassy that. That's beautiful. Our national, our national dress, pollera, and a beautiful headpiece of the pollera.
That in itself, you know, would be something interesting, you know, for marketing Panama to Egyptians.
Yes, definitely. Yeah.
When is this this costume usually worn, Mr. Abba?
Well,
celebrations and festivities.
In celebrations, this month that just passed, November. The month of November is our national month. We're not happy with having one national day. We have to have a national month. So November was the national month of Panama. There's key dates within November. So the pollera, which is the national dress, is very much used during the parades and the celebrations for our national month to celebrate our culture and our nationality.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And here we could see like an overlook
of Panama City,
the whole country.
Yes, this is the Bay of Panama, mm-hmm. Overlooking what has become the new skyline of Panama City.
Yeah, the new skyline, and in relations, the sky is the limit. Mr. Ambassador, a very important note, Egypt is a very safe place to come to.
Yes.
Egypt is a very safe place for Panamanian fellow countrymen to come and visit. Tell me more about a message, if you would like to direct a message from Cairo, from Nile TV Studios Live. Right now, for an invitation to countrymen to come to Egypt.
Well, definitely, I encourage Panamanians to come to Egypt and from Latin America, of course. There's much interest in Egypt, the pharaonic Egypt, the antiquities. Egypt offers so much, and I've been able in this year and a half that I've been living here in Egypt mm-hmm. to visit many of the places.
Yeah.
Both in,
have you tried the Egyptian Museum by night? That's the latest concern.
I have
Egyptian
not gone in that new
days,
trend.
2 days a week, Sundays and Thursdays.
Yes, I think Minister mm-hmm. Nani, the Minister of Antiquities, is doing a great job. And promoting the conservation and opening more for not only for foreign tourists but for local tourism.
Right.
I think it's also very important that Egyptians know their antiquity sites mm-hmm. and know their history and love their country through visiting these areas. I think it's also this is something that I think the minister is doing very well. I've had the opportunity to visit Upper Egypt from Luxor to Aswan, Abydos, to visit areas even in Alexandria. I think it's very beautiful, and Sohag and many other areas. So I think this is something of much interest for Panamanians and Latin Americans to come and visit this. I should also add that for many Latin Americans, as we mentioned previously in the tonight, which is mostly a Christian community. Also, the Christian, the religious tourism, of Egypt as an extension of the Holy Land is also something that is of much interest. And visiting many areas in Egypt that where Christianism, for example, the monasteries where Christian monasticism visit, where the Holy Family visited during the childhood of Jesus, and all that is very important as well to attract tourism.
Yeah.
So I think these two are main issues to attract tourism from Panama and Latin America towards Egypt.
Yeah.
And on the other side, we also would like to attract Egyptians to visit Panama.
Yeah, well, looking forward ever in relations between both countries. It was always a pleasure to have you with us, Excellency, Ambassador Thomas Guardia, Panama's ambassador to Egypt. Thank you so much, Excellency, for being with us live from Nile TV studios tonight. Thank you so much.
Always a pleasure to be here. Thank you so much.
And I thank you, dear viewers, for joining us. We talked about this important file and how we would put forward Egyptian Panamanian relations, Egypt and Panama forward, ever Egypt exposure to the whole world, open up to the whole world. That was the daily debate for tonight, and I'm Taghrid Hussein, thanking you all for watching.